everyone. Welcome back. I'm here with the wonderful Matt Mason, rock star by himself, doing all the BI power hours and incredible demos that we've seen from him in the past, presenting on SQL Server Integration Services and so on. Right, Matt?
That's right.
And Matt, you're going to walk us today around with a deep technical drill down into Power Query. No question should remain unanswered, I would say.
Well, I can go as much detail as the audience wants. Okay. So
how about you just let me pull up your bio slide here.
Sure.
Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sure. So I've been working with Microsoft for a while now. I've worked on a variety of products across SQL Server, primarily SQL Server Integration Services. So I've worked a lot with data transformation technologies. I worked with data quality services, master data services, and I've just recently switched over to the Power Query team. Power Query is a very exciting product to be working with. There's a lot of really cool functionality, and I just love what we're doing in the Power Query space.
So thinking about Power Query, I mean, a lot of the things that I see us doing is we're getting all this data in, merging it, and so on, right?
Right.
I mean, I can see there's a logical transition from you to come from SSIS and go into Power Query. Is that fair assessment?
Right, yeah. So I mean, SSIS is your traditional ETL, IT-focused. You put together these data integration solutions, and you'll still continue to do that today. The difference in Power Query is it's more of a, how we've pushed towards the self-service BI model, where people in Excel can do more and more and rely on IT less.
Yep.
It's the same thing for Power Query. Power Query can be thought of as a lightweight ETL engine, lets you do quick and easy transformations within Excel itself.
Okay, and I understand for today you have very, very little slides for us. You're basically going to walk us through demos, through some of the capabilities, through the advanced capabilities and so on, right?
That's exactly right. So I figure the best way to show Power Query is to just jump straight into the product, go through demos. I'm going to start off today with some easy demos, things that most Excel users will, you typically see in Excel. And I will go progressively more and more advanced until I get to more of the BI Pro and data scientist scenarios. So there's a lot of power in Power Query. We try to make it as simple as possible in the Excel UI, but as you will see, as I start drilling down into kind of deeper under the covers, there is a lot of power there. You can do a lot more with it than what gets exposed in the UI.
Okay, so how about we switch over to you and walk us through what you have.
I
know
in.
It's going to be amazing. So
So let me talk a little bit about the different ways to get data into Excel today. So there's a couple different experiences. Within Excel, we have the Excel Data tab, right? And there's a number of different data sources that Excel supports. This data tab has been there forever. You can point to different external data sources, pull that data into your Excel workbooks. And the great thing about it is that it creates a refreshable query. So it's not just a one-time import like you get with a copy and paste, but this is something that you can actually click refresh and bring in the latest data. So there's the Excel Data tab. Within Power Pivot, Power Pivot also has its own way of bringing in data too. And this brings in data directly into the Excel data model, into Power Pivot. Similar data sources, there's a bit more data sources in Power Pivot that you can connect to, but the experience is very similar. One of the main differences in Power Pivot is you can assign filters and apply filters as you bring the data, so you're only bringing in a subset of data at a time. So one of the things about having these two separate data experiences is a lot of Excel users can find that a bit confusing, right? Two different ways of doing things.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided to solve that by adding a third way of doing things, which is Power Query. In all seriousness, Power Query is currently an add-in that you can download for Excel. And based on the overwhelming feedback, positive feedback that we've been getting for it and usage, I expect that we'll see a tighter and tighter integration of Power Query into Excel. It's basically going to be the way to get data into Excel moving forward. Right, so Power Query has its own tab. There's a variety of data sources. Michael covered a lot of this end-to-end in his previous demo.
Can we still go over that, though?
Like, yeah, sure.
Let's have a look at the from databases, which I assume are the traditional relational databases.
Sure, yeah. So the from databases, a lot of things that you'd expect to see. So we have SQL Server, Windows Azure SQL Database, Access, Oracle DB2, MySQL, Postgres, Sybase, Teradata. So a lot of the major relational database sources.
So using the SQL connector, I would actually be able to connect to SQL Server Parallel Data Warehouse as well?
Yeah, exactly. So when you connect to SQL Server, yeah, you just connect SQL Server, you point that to your PDW, and Matt, you can connect to that as well.
Okay, perfect.
And I think Michael mentioned this as well, but we're always adding more data sources. It's one of we have a team of people always working on improving our list of connectivity and adding additional data sources. Mm-hmm. There's always new data things to connect out there too. The other thing that Power Query added is the search capability. So this lets me actually search both public data sets and data sets that are shared within my organization as well through Power BI. And this search capability has really changed the way that I know I personally do data analysis. So if I'm looking for data sets, this is now the first place I go to. I go to Power Query, and I'll search for a data set. If I can't find it here, I'll go to Bing and start searching around there. But I know the data sets I find through Power Query are things I can easily bring in. And so that's the first demo I'm going to show here. So big fan of the Olympics. I can do a search, and I get some different results. So this is a query actually created earlier that pulls in the latest medal counts. And so I can click Edit and bring up the Power Query Editor. So this is actually going to go out and evaluate the query. So it's actually rerunning that query against the backend data sources that I was originally pulling from. And from here, I can apply different transformations. So you see I have four columns. The country column is combined with the IOC code and the country name. Then I have the current medal counts. We see Canada is on top. I always like to see that.
Did you pull that in because you're Canadian?
That was part of the motivation for this demo, yes.
Can you filter out Belgium then? Just filter it out.
We'll get there. I'll probably end up filtering it out, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
So I'm just going to do a simple split. This is common operations that you do in Excel anytime you're doing some sort of data analysis. One of the things I love to say is that data is rarely BI ready. There's usually some sort of thing that you need to do, some sort of transformation process you need to do. That's why I find the data integration space so interesting. So I'm going to split on a dash and split that out. And now I have two columns. I don't really care about the code, so I'm just going to take that out. I can rename that to country. So now I have country and the different metal counts. I'm just going to do a quick aggregation. So I select my columns, click insert sum. Now I have an aggregated column.
Wow.
Total. Maybe I don't actually want the individual metal counts. So I'll move that out. Let's do something. Let's apply a filter. Sys will get rid of Belgium for you, because I'll filter anything that has greater than one metal. And that will get rid of Belgium. Greater than no medals. So any country that actually has won a medal so far in the Olympic Games. And I'll click Apply. Now I can land that data easily into my Excel workbook. Great. Now I have my total list of countries.
Interesting. I see the Netherlands there, and they don't even have any mountains. So
right, yeah, exactly. So I can actually go and edit that and further modify it. So, for example, I could sort sort country, click apply, and that brings my data back in. And so now it's not just a one-time import, right? This is actually a refreshable query, and I can actually right-click on the query itself in that little icon there in the corner here. And if I click refresh, it's actually going to go back out to the underlying data source, reapply all those transformations that I just set, and bring that into Excel. So I have a refreshable query here. And I can land and go from there.
Talking about that underlying data source, that's like a web page, or what are you using there?
In this case, I'm actually pulling from the web page itself. I had left a little comment up there saying I'm actually pulling it from the Olympic site.
Wow.
So I'm actually pulling that out and bringing it in. And I'll show different data sources throughout these different demos.
Okay.
So I searched some simple data, simple transformations. Let me go to a bit more advanced one. So this is a classic demo that the Power Query team's been showing for a while, but it really shows off some of the powerful transformations that's built into the product. So there's a site called Gapminder from Hans Rosling. This was an interesting TED talk where he does some different data analysis based on different countries. One of the ones that really stuck out to me was when he mashed up different data sets. Like he showed the BMI, the body mass index, and GDP and population growth. And so that's what I'm going to replicate here. So I'm going to search. The site has a bunch of different data sets, different indices or indicators. So here's a body mass index one. I'm just going to copy this, copy the link to the actual data, and then from Power Query, I'll do a from web, paste in that URL, and pull that data back into Excel, into Power Query. So I noticed that the data itself is separated into a couple of different sections, and so Power Query is pulling that out. The one I actually want is this data section. So I can double-click and bring up the Power Query editor. If I'm looking at the data, I see I have my countries and a bunch of numbers. I also see my first column there is actually what I want to use as column headers. So I'll click that Use First Row as Header button. So now I have columns. There's a problem with this data, right? This data is pivoted, right? It's called pivoted. So this is basically a report, right? If I want to find an individual country and year, I can do that pretty easily. But data in this format is hard to report against and hard to graph out, right? It's actually a common data format that you get. But within Power Query, I can select all the columns, click the unpivot button, and now I have the data in a better format that I can actually use.
So you selected all the columns there except the country, right?
Except the country, right.
Okay.
Yeah, because I want to keep that as my first column. Mm-hmm. I will rename these columns. So I have year, and this is my BMI. Make sure that both of these are formatted as a number. And so interesting thing, you can usually tell how long somebody has been using Power Query by whether they use the context menu or whether they use the ribbon. The ribbon was added in a later build, but most of the functionality displayed in the ribbon is also available on the right-click context menu. So I just out of habit, I always use this context menu. So I'm just going to name my query here, BMI, click Apply, and bring that into Excel. So I was watching the webcast earlier, and there's actually some questions about merging different data sets. Michael showed that you can merge data sets together. Mm-hmm. The question was, can I merge data I find in my corporate data catalog with stuff I find in other data sources? And so that's what I'm going to show here. So Power Query, I'm going to go to search. And the next thing I want to search for is GDP. And I'm going to filter this to my organization. And if I search through, I see some different data sets that different people in my organization have published. And this is actually the one I want here. So the income, so this shows the income GDP per capita. So basically, it's an indicator of wealth within a country. It's already formatted in the data I want. But I did notice there's some extra values there. So my BMI data only started in 1980. So I'm going to use this as a chance to show off filtering. So I say I want years to be greater than or equal to 1980. And so I'm going to filter out that data. I'm going to rename this query to GDP and line that. Now, I'm going to do one more merge because I want to show a three-way merge. So I'm going to bring in one more data set. So I have GDP and BMI. I'm also going to search for population. So total population. Search that out. I have another query here that was also published. Edit that. I'm going to apply a similar transformation here. So I'm just going to do a filter greater than or equal to 1980. And I need to be typing in the right box. Click OK. Call this population. Click Apply. So now I've grabbed three different data sets, brought them all together, and now I'm going to use the Power Query merge functionality. And this is a very powerful feature. This lets me merge multiple data sets, essentially do a join on them. Mm-hmm. Click merge. I have my BMI, and I'm going to join that with my GDP table. And I'm going to select multiple columns because I have more than one key. I want to join on both the country and the year. Down at the bottom here, we do a quick analysis to show how many rows are going to be matched. And I have the option to say only include the matching rows. In relational terms, this is an inner join. Or I can include all rows, which would be an outer join. Yeah. In this case, I only want to take the rows that exist in both data sets. So I'll do an inner join here, click OK. And now this has been joined as what we call a nested table. I could then expand that table to make a flat data set. I'm just going to select the GDP column, flatten that out, rename this to GDP. So now I've joined my BMI data set and my GDP data set together. I'm going to go one step further and do a three-way merge. So join that data set with my population statistics. Select the same columns. In this case, we see that it was a full match. All rows in the data set matched. So I'll click OK. Expand that as well. rename
so that really emerged is basically a feature that sits in GA, right? I don't think it was there in earlier previews, correct?
So in earlier previews, you needed to apply and close the query and then do a second merge. So you end up with multiple queries together. Now you can actually do the single merge step in a single query.
And that basically comes based on customer feedback.
Exactly. So one of the things, one of the fantastic things about the Power Query team is we've been able to release on a monthly basis, and so we address feedback quickly. Basically on a monthly release cycle, adding new functionality and new features, which is actually a bit challenging as a demo person who does these things at conferences, especially in a new build and all the functionality is buttons have been shifted around based on new feedback, but. Anyways, that's one of the exciting things of being a Microsoft presenter. So I've merged all these data sets together. I've done a three-way merge, very simply, right? Bring it all together. I land my data in Excel. And again, Power Query is all about getting data into Excel. We call it the get data experience. And I typically want to do something like plot this out now. So I will do a quick Power View map to plot out this data set together.
Okay, so this is basically what you're going to show now is, hey, I can grab this, build a quick Power View out of it. And I think that's one of the things that a lot of people want to do, right? Just go out there, get some data, whether that's corporate or publicly available, and know how to easily and how simple you could put that into a Power View.
Right? Yeah, exactly. I mean, a lot of the time you may just be pulling in data and just having a plain data table in Excel is enough. But most of the time, you actually want to visualize it. Mm-hmm. And so here I've added a scatter plot graph. I'm going to, let's put year on the play axis. I'm going to add country to the details. And so basically what I'm showing here is we have GDP coming up here. So the higher the bubble, the higher GDP per capita, or average income per person, basically. Mm-hmm. And I have the BMI, so it's an indicator of health. And if I click play...
It's like what, body mass index?
Body mass index. So as I click play, we see that all the bubbles are moving to the right. So basically the world is getting fatter as we go, which is an interesting indicator. Right? And so if I add a filter here, so I add population to my filter, and just remove some of the higher population countries, just so we get a bit fewer bubbles. So we see, like U.S., for example, is increasing in both GDP and population and BMI over the years. It's actually really interesting, the gap that's growing between U.S. and other countries. Anyways, this was a really quick visualization that we could throw together, a mashup of three different data sets, brought it together easily and visualized it. And I can get real data insight by doing these things.
That was indeed, that was like really quick. Wow, I grabbed the data, bang, mash it up a little, and just bring that straight into a Power View. And I think there's a lot of use cases for that specifically, right?
Right, exactly.
Now, one of the things I noticed is you're loading all this data into the Excel workbooks.
Right.
One of the questions that came up on the channels as well is like, what about larger volumes of data? What if I have 4 million records, for example?
I was going to touch on that a bit later. So when you're importing into Power Query, when you're importing data using Power Query, actually I can show that really, really quick. Let me show my workbooks here, and I'll do the edit. There's an option down in the bottom corner here, my load settings. So here, by default, I can load to the worksheet. So that's for data that will easily fit into an Excel table. So I brought it in. It's going to land in the Excel worksheet. For larger data sets, I can load to the data model. And the data model, of course, is what we call Power Pivot. So I can, for when I'm dealing with large amounts of data, I typically load directly into the data model. And actually, I'll cover that in a little bit later on in my demo. Great. So I did that three-way merge. Let's go to a simpler scenario. I'm just going to start a new workbook. I'll point to a relational source. This is another common thing that you'll do. I'm just going to import from SQL Server. So I go Power Query from database, point to SQL Server. I have a local SQL instance here. When I connect to it, it shows all the different databases I have running on the SQL instance. I'm going to drill down and find one of the tables I want. I can hover over and see the preview for each of this data. And let's do the finance table. And I can click load, that will just load it directly into the worksheet, or I can click edit. I want to show a couple of different things when working with relational sources. So I'd shown earlier I can apply filters, right? So say if I apply a filter, says, for example, finance key less than 20 to filter out some of my rows. So I've basically filtered out in this view. What is actually happening? When I click apply, Power Query is going to fold that filter that I've just applied to the backend query. So Power Query tries to be as smart as it can when it comes to filters and joins and things like that. We call this functionality query folding. So Power Query is going to look at your end-to-end query that you've built up in the UI and push back as much work as it can to the backend data source. So when it's working with a fully functional backend source like SQL Server and most relational sources, it can actually fold these things directly into the underlying SQL query. So this happens even if I am joining multiple data sets, for example. It's going to fold everything together, push that join into the source query, so it's only pulling back the data that I actually need. When you're working with data sources that don't have a backend databases, like a flat file, a CSV file, Power Query is going to do the work itself in memory. But basically, it tries to offload as much work as possible to that backend source, and that's how Power Query gets a lot of its performance.
Wait, question on this one, because you totally lost me there.
Okay.
So what you're basically saying in this example is I just click to one of my dimension tables.
Yep.
It gives me a preview of the data.
That's right.
Then I decide which columns I want.
That's right.
And I decide which filter I want. So basically, if that will be a select statement, which where clause. And,
exactly.
And rather than pulling the entire data set in, what it does, it actually sends that query and with the where clause and the conditions, sends that back to SQL and then pulls it in.
Exactly. So Power Query always tries to be as smart as it can about the way it does filter. If it did all these filters in memory, there's always a performance penalty. But usually a database, the backend database system, can do this work a lot more efficiently than the client tool can do. So we try to offload as much of that work as possible.
Yeah, because I think with a lot of people, the assumption was like, no, it's going to grab all that data and it's going to filter it in Excel, and now I'm sitting with all that data in Excel first, which it doesn't. It actually sends it out, gets it back, and that's a key feature. That's important.
Exactly. So actually, because that's an important concept, let me walk through this again, and I'll call out exactly what would be folded back to that query that actually gets run. So here I have my finance table again. Like you said, it actually pulls back a sample of the data. So if I scroll down, it's actually going to show that this is a preview of the data, right? So it limits the amount of data it's actually going to pull in. It doesn't want to overwhelm you with the entire data set. But it still gives you enough data so that as you apply your transformations, you get an idea of what the shape of the data is going to be.
So that's like a select top statement, basically.
That's exactly how it is. Mm-hmm. So if I remove different columns here, right? So if I'm connected to the whole table, it's basically like a select star. If I remove these columns, I'm only selecting the columns that I actually want. Mm-hmm. If I apply a filter, right? So if I say greater than or less than 20, this would then include that in the underlying where clause that gets run on the database, things like that. The other thing that I want to call out are these additional columns at the end here, right? You see these things with the special icon in the side. This is showing the relationships that we detected. So we connected to a relational data source, and there's some foreign key relationships that show how these tables are related to one another. And so Power Query surfaces that right away. And this lets you basically collapse those subtables into your current view. So for example, I could say, okay, dim account, I want the account description. And then bring that right into this table. Dim date isn't that interesting, but my department, I want to bring in the department group name. Right? So this lets me collapse. So in a common scenario, I'm dealing with data warehouse in data warehouses, and I have multiple dimensions, and maybe I have a snowflake schema, right, where I have a fact table to a dimension and then multiple subdimensions. I might want to collapse that all down to a star schema where I have, you know, a single layer of dimensions in there that makes the tabular reporting against it a lot easier. Right, so I can do all this directly from the Power Query UI. So when I do those types of joins, right, those types of collapses, Power Query then includes that as part of the join SQL statement that gets run in the backend. Okay, so that is basically I showed You can collapse. Power Query does this thing called query folding. It collapses all this stuff into the SQL that gets run. I can quickly do things like seeing the table relationships and collapse things together. To go a bit more advanced, if I import multiple tables, so I'm going to select multiple tables here. I'm going to import my customer table, my product dimensions, and let's pick a fact table. So my internet sales. I see here, because I've selected multiple tables, it's going to load to the data model by default, so load directly into Power Pivot. Click Load, and it's going to pull these data sets back in parallel. So you see it pulling all the data, loading it into Power Query, and I can hover over to it for a preview. And then once this is up, I'll open up the Power Query Power Pivot model and show the different relationships that it's detected and displayed. Okay, so that's been loaded. I'll go to Power Pivot once it starts responding. Click Power Pivot, click Manage, and now I see it's actually imported those tables directly into my data model.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if I go to the diagram view, I see that Power Query has detected the relationships between the tables and included those relationships as part of my data model import. Okay, so for example, it shows that my fact internet sales is related to my product, my dim product dimension linked on the product key, right? And so actually, this is an example of that snowflake schema where I have multiple dimensions linked to one another.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Power Query, because it can look at the relational engine and detect those foreign key relationships, it then translates that into the data model if you import all those tables together. Power Query will also even do it if you're not using a relational data source where those relationships are defined. So if, for example, if I'm pointing to multiple flat files and I say that columns can be joined and import those tables together, Power Query will detect that there's a relationship there and translate that to the data model as well. All right, so Power Query, again, it tries to be as smart as it can when you're working with different data sets. Okay, so that was some relational stuff. Let's show some flat file work. So again, Power Query is all about saving you time. And one of the things I love most about demoing Power Query is that when you are showing this to an audience, you see their eyes light up, right? Because they think, this is going to save me hours of work. So common operation is importing from a flat file. So I'm going to bring up this. And
do you want to ask the audience to send us pictures of their eyes?
Eyes lighting up? That's one of the things I love most about demoing this in front of the audience. I can see it from the stage, looking into the crowd and seeing all the excitement there. And let me just open up this file. So this is a flat file of customers. So now Excel already has a great import experience when you're working with flat files. It actually provides a number of different options. You have a bunch of different formats. Power Query tries to make this a bit easier. It tries to do things like detecting that your first row is headers, for example, detecting data types and things like that. It tries to auto-detect the delimiters. So I've imported the file, and I want to do some simple transformations. So I'm just going to split by delimiter, on comma. So now I have, this is family name, that one, and this is given name. Maybe I want to reverse the column order, split this around, and great, this is my customer's info, and I've imported my flat file, click apply, go. Another cool feature that we have is this append functionality. So append lets me point to multiple files and bring all that data together in a single table, right? Quickly append data. Power Query lets you do this on a larger scale as well. So if you notice, there's a from file, and you actually import from a folder. Okay. So in this case, I have a folder with different sales data. So In this case, I have a header file. This tells me what my headers are going to be. And then I have my sales data split across four different files. So my data is all divided by year. Again, common thing, you partition your data by year or by month. And now I want to aggregate all that data together in a single view. And Power Query lets me do this very easily. So again, I will do from folder. And I will import from this folder. And so this view I'm getting here is actually the view of the folder itself. So I see all my different files and the extensions, and I see some file properties. If I click on attributes, I'm actually going to see individual attributes of each file. So for example, the size. So I can see the size of every file. And there's some interesting stuff. Sometimes I actually do want to get this sort of analysis within Power Query itself. In this case, I'm mostly interested in the file contents themselves. If I click on one of these individual binary links, I'm going to parse that one file. If I click on this icon up here, it tells Power Query to combine all these files together. So basically, apply whatever transformations I'm going to apply, do it on all files in this directory. That's what I'm going to do here. So I've parsed out the files. It's detected the headers. It's detected that it's CSV. It puts it into this shape for me. Mm-hmm. The columns that I'm interested in for this demo are the sales amount and order date. So I'll say remove other columns. Now, if I wanted to do some deep analysis on this, I could bring this into Power Pivot and apply some transformations, do my aggregates there. In this case, I just want to suck the data into Excel. Curious about the data, I can actually apply some aggregates and group bys directly within Power Query as well.
Nice.
So here I basically have sales amounts for each sale on a given day. I want to aggregate this together to get the total amount of sales per day. So I'll click the group by column, group by order date. I want to apply a sum on the sales amount. I'll call this total sales. Click OK. Now I have an aggregate. So it's doing an aggregate over that CSV files or the group of CSV files that I've applied. Click Apply, bring the data into Excel. And now, see we have 2005 data. If I scroll down, I see that it's also seamlessly included the 2006 data. So this actually jumped files from one file to another here seamlessly, and the Power Query just basically takes all that and puts it all together for you.
Now let's go bigger here, right? Because what I can do is I can actually run Windows Azure HD Insight and have the results of Hive jobs and so on and Hive queries stored onto the Windows Azure storage and use the same method and the same mechanisms to import this, right?
Yeah, let's take a look at that. I wasn't going to show that, but now you bring it up. That's actually a great point. So, so I can actually connect to HD Insight, right? And when I do that,
take the sensor data, for example, that Michael showed in the initial.
Well, sure.
There you go.
Yeah. Perfect. So basically, I'll connect to the I connect to the backend HD Insight file system, right? Uh-huh. And on this in this file system, I have a list of results that I've gotten from Hive queries and things like that. So this is actually showing a lot of different data. So I want to let's filter this to find some good data I can work with. CSV data, and I have some NASDAQ daily prices here. So let's actually do that. So let's do text filter begins with NASDAQ, and that filters out. Yeah, so actually I have two different types of NASDAQ files. Let me apply an additional filter on top of that. So I want those things that include the name daily prices. All right, so now I actually have multiple CSV files from my HD Insight server done alphabetically. And if I check the record, I can actually see that, so each file is about 50 megs in size, and I have full alphabet, so I have about a gig of data here.
Mm-hmm.
And let's parse it with Power Query. So again, when I click the combine, it's going to combine all those CSV files together. Key thing here is that we are only dealing with a subset of the data, right? It's going to be a sample of the data. It doesn't pull back the entire gigabyte of data set. It's just the sample that I can start filtering and shaping to get it into the shape I want, and I'll only start pulling it all down after I do an apply.
Yeah.
So say I want to pull in data. Let's see. Let's just apply a simple filter. If I say, click too much here. If I say filter by date, for example.
Between. Could you go back to that real quick?
Sure.
Okay. So looking at the capabilities there, I mean, one of the things that especially if you're writing Transact SQL is like, how do I find all the records that had data from the last month or this month or whatever?
Right.
So if I were to say, I mean, and I know probably with this data set we can't do that, but if I were to say, I want this to come from the last month, when I refresh my query, my definition will refresh and I will always get the last month.
Exactly. Right? Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm going to, let's just do a between filter here. Let's pull in all the data from 11/01/2009, because that's what I have here, and 01/01/2010. So it's going to apply my filter here, and if I scroll down, I can see it's limiting that data set. Mm-hmm. So again, because I'm working with big data, the big data results, I have over a gig of data, I wouldn't want to load to the worksheet. I'd want to load directly into my Power Pivot model, so I'll do that.
And one of the key reasons there is the fact that you're compressing this, right?
Exactly. So one of the key mm-hmm. advantages of the data model, of Power Pivot itself, mm-hmm. is the VertiPack, sort of the X-Velocity engine that lets you compress the data and do the in-memory BI on top of it.
Yeah, so I did that on a data set that was publicly available, which was the New York City 311 call data. Mm-hmm. And I was surprised to see that a 4 gig CSV file with the transformations I did with Power Query and the columns that I actually wanted out of it,
right,
that I was able to put that entire data set into a workbook that was less than 160 megs. I mean, I thought that by itself was just impressive.
Right. Yeah, exactly. So in this case, I pulled down a limited number of set because a limited number of data because I did a filter here. Let's actually remove that filter and let me try pulling down all of the data. So again, I can go back to my query and just remove my previous transformations. So I'll click on that one to remove that filter I added. Click apply and refresh. Let's see if we can catch it actually downloading. So we actually see the data downloading and the size here. Uh-huh. I can actually cancel it. I don't want it to pull down the full 1 meg data set. One gig data set. So I'll cancel. But I actually see the status and progress as the data is actually coming down.
Perfect.
Great. So let's talk about some things. The things that I liked most about Power Query when I first saw it. So I mentioned about those different steps, right, that I can actually click and remove steps and see the different steps. And as I click through these different steps, I actually see step-by-step transformations that I applied. So the different filters I applied, the importing as CSV, the first row as header, the changing the data types, right, and I actually see all those different steps. And if I go to the View tab and enable the formula bar, I can also see that there's different formulas being applied every time that I click on one of these steps. So this is very much like Excel, where in Excel you apply these different formulas. If I go to a view and see the advanced editor, I can also see code behind. So Power Query has a language underneath. We call it the Power Query formula language. And this is fully documented, and there's lots of examples out there. But as a BI pro, as a developer, this is what interested me most. So as soon as I started using Power Query, I took a look at this and started wondering what else I can do with this language. Now, I mentioned earlier, our UI tries to make this as easy as possible, right? It provides a lot of the common steps that you do, but you can always go right down to the code itself and basically create a query from scratch using the Power Query formula language. So let's talk a little bit about that. Again, this is really expected to be more of an advanced, BI pro or data scientist type scenario. But again, it really shows the power of Power Query. So I can go to from other data sources and actually start with a blank query. Bring this up. Now I have a query bar and I can do things like, let me zoom in. And I could do things like hello world. Right, now I have a string, hello world. I can do 1 plus 1, which isn't that interesting because I actually typed 1 plus 1, but if I make it into a formula with the equal sign, now I have a 2. And I can do that, and I get 9 because I'm bad at math, but if I knew what I was doing, I could do that. Right, now I have 16. So, really simple types of formulas. There's also a lot of built-in library functions. So list.date, for example, is an interesting one. List.dates, actually. And if I type in the formula name, I can see the function and I see the details, like the its parameters and description and maybe some examples as well. There's this invoke button that lets me call the function. So for example, I'll say I want to call this, my start date is the first for 2003, and I want 365 days, and I want every day. This gives me a list of dates. Convert that to a table, call this value, and I can start inserting some custom columns. So for example, date.year, type in the value. Okay, call this year. I can add another column here, date.month. All right, you can see here, as I build up and add additional columns, I'm essentially creating a date dimension, right? I could build my own date dimension.
And that's exactly where some people struggle with when we think about Power Pivot, right? I mean,
right.
This would be, wow, this is...
Yeah. Right, exactly. So I could build this up manually, but I also pre-created this query. I can go and replace the whole existing query that I just built up with my existing one. And now I have an actual full date dimension here. Right, my date, my year keys, the quarter, the month names, the day of week, right, all without going to an extra data source. This is just purely using the Power Query library functions.
Wow. Huh.
When you see the additional steps, there's this little icon. It means there's a wizard or a helper that can help you do things. So in this case, I had created a simple function called create date table. If I click this, it will show me how to invoke it with my different parameters. I decided when I created this function, I actually take in a culture. So for example, I could switch this to French. And now I have the month names and day of weeks coming back in French. Right? So very cool capabilities, very cool, very powerful stuff that I can do just using the formula language. And if you search around, I've actually blogged about how to do dynamic lookups against address cleansing services, for example, or calling OData services as part of the data transformation and import. So you can do some, it unlocks some very, very cool data transformation capabilities. One of the things you'll find in Power Query is, especially when I'm using it, is I'll go between using the UI and then moving down to the code level to do different things. Because I like that visual view. I like that as I apply a transformation, I can see exactly what it's doing to my data set. So I know I'm doing the right thing. So I'm going to show another demo here where I'll do a mix of using the UI and also the code. So let's cancel out of this. And I will go to a website that I have open called Box Office Mojo. This site shows different, basically the top grossing movies, so the overall domestic grosses for different movies. And it lays it out in a common format you'll see on the web where there's multiple tabs or multiple pages of data, right? So I have 1 to 100 here, 101 to 200 here. And so there's multiple pages, and if I scroll down, I'll see that it has about the top 100 rows, and then there's some additional data at the bottom, a summary and stuff like that.
So those are the kind of things that in the past, typically, when someone would go to the website, copy from one page, go to the other page, copy it again, paste it in Excel, those kind of things, right?
Right, yeah. So, yeah, if you're typical Excel power user, yeah, the copy and paste, maybe you'd write a VBA macro, maybe you'd do some more advanced transformations with scripting or build a repeatable process using SSIS or something like that. But what I'm going to show here is how to combine the UI of Power Query and some of the more advanced scripting stuff or the coding stuff behind it. So I'll copy that URL, and here I'm going to do from web, paste in the URL itself, and it's going to show me the different tables that we detect on the table itself, on that web page. So that's not the one I want. This looks like what I want. I'm going to pull back all the data.
So pause that for a second.
Sure.
You just copy-pasted in the URL from a web page.
That's right.
And it gives you back the table structure.
Yeah, exactly. So Power Query is going to go look and find the different tables as defined. Yeah. Actually, one of the interesting things there is the third result is always the document itself. So if Power Query can't find a table, you can actually drill into the HTML document to tell it where to find the data that you want. Okay, so I'm pulling back the data. I'm just going to rename a column here. And if I scroll down, I can see that it's pulled back 100 rows. And I don't want these last three rows. So I'm just going to do a keep top row button and keep the top 100 rows. And that will truncate those summary rows at the bottom that I don't want. Great. Now, I am going to... So that pulled back the first page of data. I want to make this into a repeatable function that I can reuse to pull back multiple pages. So I'm going to open up the advanced editor. I'm going to add a parameter, page num. And then let me zoom in so people can see. So I see there's actually a page argument in my URL itself. So I'm going to split this up. I'm going to concatenate some strings. I'm going to say text.toNumber. Pass in my argument, page num. Okay, so it's basically taking in that page number argument and replacing it into the URL. So I'm going to pull back the page that I want. Click done. And text.toNumber, that's because I used the wrong function. What I actually want is number.toText. Pass in page number. Thank you. Very helpful Power Query errors here. And now I can press invoke. If I type in page number one, that's basically the data I got back before. I see the rank one, right? Mm-hmm. And if I change that to pull in page number two, now I have a different page of data. So now I'm pulling back the second tab. And I think I can go all the way up to page number seven. And there's a problem in that page number seven doesn't pull in the full 100 rows. Remember I did the top 100? Because I did that top 100 and I have less than 100 rows, I'm still getting that summary information.
Okay.
So I'm going to go back and fix that, actually. So if I go back to my advanced editor here.
So how are you going to fix that?
Well, so I'd hard-coded in that 100, right? I'm actually mm-hmm. going to make this a dynamic thing. So I'm going to say table.rowCount and pass in that name of the table. And minus three. So basically, this is saying take the total number of rows, strip off the last three summary rows, click done. Let's try this again, make sure this works. So if I do page seven, now those summary rows are gone. Right, so I've actually dynamically now using the data within my data set, applying another function, and pulling in just the rows I want. OK, great. So let's keep that function. We're going to call this getPage. Okay. And created a function, and now that function is going to be reusable across multiple queries. So if I go and create a new Power Query from blank, I'm going to say I want a list. Let me zoom in here. I want a list of numbers from 1 to 7 as a formula. Convert that to a table. Call this page. Add a new custom column. I'm actually going to invoke that function that I just called getPage. Add in page. Click OK. So now for every page number that I just created, it's going to dynamically invoke that function and bring back all the data together. So if I scroll down a bit more, I can see I went from the page one call to the page two call seamlessly here, too.
Just like that.
Yeah. So I'm actually doing dynamic invocation here. And you can imagine scenarios. I did a simple list of numbers, but I could actually be pulling in that list from a database. I could be pulling in a list of URLs. I could be pulling in a list of dates. I could be pulling in anything and merging or mashing up these data sets together. So that was sort of the more advanced functionality that I showed. Again, this is more of a BI Pro data scientist type scenario, but it's one of the things that I'm most excited about Power Query is these advanced capabilities here. That's pretty much it for my demos. Just to quickly recap what I showed today. So I showed Power Query. It's an add-in for Excel. You can download it and install it. You have it's able to connect to a number of different data sources. We're always adding more, continuing to enhance that. So you connect to your traditional data sources, relational sources, other cloud-based data sources, web pages, files. You can connect to a directory of files, easily combine all those files together. Do big data processing, connect to HD Insight, and pull back the results of your Hive queries. Bring all that back for analysis. You can bring data back, land it in an Excel worksheet, bring it back and land it in an Excel data model, and then do further modeling on top of it using Power Pivot. Bring the data in, do some analysis using Power View. You can do things like groups and aggregates within Power Query itself. And one of the most powerful features of Power Query is the fact that these filtering and shaping and all the different transformations that you're applying will get pushed back to the back-end data source for more efficient, high-performance types of joins, and basically it lets you pull back only the data you need rather than pulling back the entire data set and trying to do everything in memory.
Wow. So you're not off the hook yet, because I got a lot of questions to ask. Like what, for example, if the document that I'm trying to open is not a CSV file, but it's like a JSON document, for example?
Sure. So that's actually a great question. If I maybe let me pull up one of my files here. So if you notice my different steps, maybe this isn't a great one, but I can actually say, I can say from my source file, I can do a text transformation and actually say that the data itself is a JSON document or an XML document. Mm-hmm. Right? CSV is just one of the text formats that we actually support. So again, loading a JSON document. Actually, here's a tip. If you're looking to grab web data, always look at the page, because a lot of web pages will actually be loading the data from a JSON document, and you can get a URL to the JSON itself, mm-hmm. pull that into Power Query, tell Power Query that it's a JSON format, and it will automatically parse it up and show nested tables and sub-relationships and things like that.
Yeah, I think one of the examples that Ari is going to be showing later today when we do the power map is we're actually going to map that to the one of the open data set APIs.
Okay.
And a lot of those APIs, like we're going to be using the New York City data set, a lot of those APIs just generate JSON. So you could then just say, "Hep, here's my document, transform it to a table, select the columns you need," just the same way, right?
Right. So Power Query tries to be as smart as it can. It will try to do an analysis and see if it's CSV. But yeah, things like JSON, sometimes it auto-detects it. Most of the time you need to tell it that it is JSON. Once you do that, it'll just parse it up.
Then one of the other things I noticed when you started your beginning demo when you were looking at the body mass index, it was quite intriguing to see that you copy-pasted the URL to the Excel workbook rather than downloading the workbook, storing it locally, and then use that as a data source, because you can do that as well. But
right.
why did you just put that to the URL instead of?
So actually, when I was preparing this, so Power Query can pull in the data from multiple formats. So that website actually pulled down the data as a CSV. I can port directly from web. I can click from web and do the CSV loading. But just in case we had web connectivity issues, I actually had pre-downloaded those files just so I could point to the file system instead. Power Query lets you do it both ways. In this case, pulling from the web is a bit better than doing a cached version, because I can actually make it refreshable, right? Every query that I create, I can then click refresh at a later date to pull in the latest data.
So that basically is when someone were to... Okay, I see. So you're sitting on a website, you're pulling in an Excel document.
Right.
When that document sits on a website, if that gets updated, you still have that refreshed update.
Yeah, exactly. And so if I go back to my my Olympic example, right, pulling in the Olympic medals, that actually does pull in the latest data every single time.
Okay.
So I don't know if anybody's won a medal since we started here. See if any of the counts change.
Maybe Belgium did. Could you unfilter that?
We see Poland was added. So I guess Poland won a medal since I last refreshed. So you see actually it's actually pulling in the latest live data from the Olympic website.
What about query folding?
Query folding?
Yeah.
What about it?
Do we support that?
To websites? So we basically support folding to any data source that supports it. So things like websites or flat files or data, those things don't accept folding. But Power Query will actually do those joins in memory. But if you're connecting to an OData service, for example, right? OData services do support filtering and folding like relational sources do. Power Query in that case would, in fact, fold that to the backend data source.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Right?
With that stunning presentation, as always,
thank you.
Typically something I expect from you. Thanks for being here, Matt.
Yeah, so welcome.
What we're going to do now is we're going to take a 10-minute break, and then we're going to look to the next session in which we're going to look much more into the data catalog with Matthew Roach coming up.
Great.
Okay, so we'll be back in 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thanks.